So friends, next we are going to see about the Public Service Commission. So there are three Public Service Commission. One is Union Public Service Commission, that is UPSC. Next is the State Public Service Commission, which is the SPSC, and Joint Public Service Commission, which is the JPSC. Okay. So the article, first we will see about the UPSC. Okay. The articles covered is 315 to 323. Part is 14. Part 14 of the Constitution deals with the Union Public Service Commission. The article is from 315 to 323. Okay. So, first we will see about the composition. Okay. While dealing with the tabular column, the overview I told. The composition, it is left to the president. Okay. So, the president will fix the strength of this Public Service Commission. So, as of now, there will be a chairman. A chairman of UPSC. And below that, some members will be there. That number will be fixed by the president. Then and there. Okay. Usually, there will be some 9 to 11 members. 9 to 11 members plus one chairman of UPSC. Okay. So, that is the thing. With the composition, both the chairman and members of the UPSC are appointed by the president. Okay, that is very clear. Composition and appointment. Next is with the term or tenure. What is the term or tenure? 6 years or 65 years of age. Whichever is earlier, they will take that into consideration. Okay, that is with respect to your term and tenure. And is there any qualification for this post? For becoming chairman of UPSC or member of UPSC, there is no qualification mentioned in your constitution except only one thing, that is half of the members, okay, including the chairman, okay, half of the members should held office for 10 years under the government of India or under any state governments. Okay, so there is no such qualifications. There is no qualification for becoming a chairman or member, but there is only one qualification, that is half of the members of the UPSC including the chairman should have hold office for 10 years under any government, government of India or under any state. Okay, only half of the members, that is the necessary thing. Okay, so that is with the qualification and term. And when the president can appoint a chairman is when the chairman's post is vacant, when the chairman of UPSC's seat is vacant, or when the chairman is unable to perform his duties, then your president can appoint one of the members of UPSC as the chairman. Okay, so there are some 9 to 11 members. So if the chairman is unable to perform duties or he is vacant from his post, means then any one member will be appointed by the president. Okay, that is the thing. Next we'll go to the removal. With respect to removal, UIE, these are the grounds. Okay, U means unfit. If on the opinion of president, if he is unfit, then insolvent. Okay, if he is a dissolved insolvent on the view of the president, then E means engages. Okay, if he is engaging in any other office which is giving a payment, okay, when he is during the tenure of his office, okay, while he is a member or while he is a chairman, he is engaging in some private trade which gives him money, means that is also on ground. Okay, so UIE, U means unfit, I means insolvent, and E means engages. In these three grounds, your president can remove. Okay, your president can remove the chairman or the members of UPSC, but on the ground of misbehavior. Okay, if the ground is on misbehavior, means then your president will consult or refer that case to the Supreme Court. Then your Supreme Court will form a body which will investigate those case, and the Supreme Court will give an advice to the president, and that advice given by Supreme Court is binding on the president. Okay, so that is very important. The advice given by Supreme Court for removing the chairman or the members is binding on the president. Okay, this thing I have told while dealing with the tableau column overview, I told. Okay. So that is with the removal and composition term. Next is with the independency. Okay, we all know, because your Public Service Commission is only recommending. Okay, it is only recommending the civil service aspirants. Okay, to the government. So it should be an independent body. It should have some independent functions. No. So one of the independent functions is with the removal. He cannot be removed from office such like that. Okay, he can be removed only by the president. When that also the president should refer the case to Supreme Court, then only with respect to advice of Supreme Court, only your member or chairman of UPSC can be removed. Okay, so that is one important independency given to the UPSC chairman or member. Okay, that is one ground of independency. Next is with the salaries of UPSC member or chairman are charged on the consolidated fund of India. What is meant by this charged fund that I have dealt while dealing with the parliament? Okay, the charged things cannot be put to vote. Okay, so that is also an independence given to the UPSC chairman or member. Then another one thing is with respect to, he is not eligible for reappointment. Okay, your UPSC members or chairman, they are not eligible to reappointment to that same office again. Okay, here one understanding is very important. If a member of UPSC can be appointed as the chairman of UPSC, that is no problem. But the member of UPSC, after the end of his tenure, he cannot be appointed again as a member. Okay, the same thing with chairman. The chairman of UPSC cannot be appointed again as the chairman of the UPSC, or else the chairman cannot become member also. Okay, if the chairman of UPSC is there after end of tenure, you should go to home only. Okay, that is one independency ground given to the member or chairman of UPSC. That is with the independency. Next is with the functions. What are the functions? So with respect to functions, that is a code word. That is your ether tap. Okay. So this is one of the code word to remember the functions of UPSC, ether tap. Okay, in that your E means examination. Okay, your UPSC is going to conduct exam for recruiting civil service for the government of India. Okay, that is conducting of exams. And A is for assisting the state. Okay, your UPSC can assist the state government. So if the state government is requesting to the UPSC, then with the approval of the president and with the approval of the governor of the concerned state, then your UPSC can assist the state government in conducting some exams or whatever help the state is asking for. Okay, that is assisting of the state. And your T for temporary office. Okay, for recruitment of some temporary office, that also your UPSC can do. But temporary office means it should exceed 1 year. That office should have a term exceeding 1 year. Below 1 year means then UPSC can't do anything with that. Okay, if a temporary office exceeding 1 year means, then your UPSC can conduct and recruit exam for that office also. That is T. And your R for reimbursement. Okay, what do you mean reimbursement? Repay of money. Okay, if a person has lost some money, okay, what to say, if any dispute is there, okay, if a civil servant has been removed from his office, then he's going to court and claiming that he's a good person only, that he's claiming and the case is going on, and the final verdict is that okay, he's a good man, and they are again claiming him to the office, means that amount which has lost. Okay, that amount lost by that civil servant in these proceedings, that amount can be reimbursed. Okay, that will be done by UPSC only. Okay, that is your reimbursement. And here your TAP means it is your, so with respect to this, your TAP, it is your transfer and temporary office. We all know for temporary office also your UPSC is only conducting and recruiting exam. That temporary office should not be less than 1 year. Okay, that is your temporary. And your this P for pensions. Okay, it is also UPSC is also relating with the pensions. Okay, pensions of civil servants, that is also under the ambit of UPSC only. And this P is for the promotions. Okay, your promotions and transfers, promotions and transfers of a civil service, that is also coming under the ambit of UPSC only. Okay, on the recommendation of UPSC only, your promotions and transfer from one civil service to another can be done. Okay, so that is the functions given under the Public Service Commission. Okay, next we'll see about the, okay, so what happens is that is a legal battle between UPSC and your Central Vigilance Commission. Okay, that is a legal battle going on between your UPSC and Central Vigilance Commission. Your UPSC is a constitutional body and your Central Vigilance Commission is a non-constitutional body. Okay, what happens is during if a civil servant after being appointed to the government job, if that civil servant who is appointed is misbehaving or he's not following the rules, means then he should be removed. No, for removing that, government will consult. Okay, the government will consult both this UPSC and your CVC. Okay, The consultation is with UPSC and CVC. This is a constitutional body and this is non-constitutional bodies. Okay. So, most of the time, there is a clash between these two, UPSC and CVC. But mostly, your UPSC wins over because your UPSC is having an edge over your CVC because it is a constitutional body. Okay. So, it is having an edge. Another one important point, the directions and functions, okay, given by this UPSC is just an advisory or it's just an recommendatory one. Okay, it is just a recommended body. Okay, because the UPSC is just a recruiting agency. Okay, it will conduct exam and it will give that merit list to the government. It is up to the government to take the decision. Okay, to implement the decision. Okay, so the functions and directions given by the UPSC is not a mandatory one. It is just an directionary one. Okay, so that is with respect to one functions and the jurisdiction. Okay, the jurisdiction of UPSC. There is some certain jurisdiction. No, within that limit only your UPSC can have its functions. That jurisdiction of UPSC can be extended. Okay, can be extended by an act of the parliament. Okay, when a parliament is producing an act, then the jurisdiction of UPSC can be extended. That is one. That is one extra point you should note here. And another one extra thing is, I told these functions are not mandatory. The functions given by UPSC is just a directionary one, and it is not a mandatory thing. The next one is the president can include. Okay, your president can include or exclude the post. That is under the ambit of UPSC. There are some certain posts, no. That is only will come under the ambit of UPSC. This post can be altered by the president. Okay. UPSC is not having any power with respect to including or excluding of that post, but your president is having that power. Okay. Also, your president, when he is doing such thing, when he is excluding or including some post, that thing, that direction of the president should be presented in the parliament. Okay. It should be submitted to the parliament for some 14 days. It should get the approval of the parliament. Then only your president can do that. Okay. So, the president is not acting solely. On its own, he is not doing. He should pass that or submit that report to the parliament to get the approval. Okay, then only you can exclude or include the post. So have this thing in mind. The jurisdiction of UPSC can be extended by an act of parliament. On the other hand, the post under the ambit of UPSC can be varied by the president after the approval of the parliament. These are the extra things you should note here. So that is with your Union Public Service Commission. Next we'll go to the State Public Service Commission. Okay. Before going to the State Public Service Commission, one thing is very important here. You should know some history, how this Public Service Commission was emerged. Okay. So, if you have a good knowledge of modern India, you could easily relate to this history. Okay. Because all the things started by Charter Act of 1833. Okay. By this act, one provision is there. Okay. They tried to conduct this open civil service examination and they wanted to include this Indians in this open civil service examination, but that provision was not taken forward. Okay. By the Charter Act of 1853, the provision what I have told earlier, that was done by the Charter Act of 1853 and a committee called Macaulay Committee. You all know, no? A Macaulay Committee was set up to take forward that provisions. Okay, that is one important point. Next, what happened is in 1923, the year is very important. 1923, it is the Royal Commission. The Royal Commission under Lee Barker. Okay, 1923, Royal Commission under Lee of Faraman, under the leadership of Lee of Faraman was set up. This Royal Commission gave recommendation that 40% of the civil servants should be elected or should be taken from the British, and 40% directly from the Indians, and some 20% from the provincial service. Okay, there is some provincial service. No, provincial means Madras province, Bengal province, like that. They will have some respective service. No, some 20% should be represented from the provincial service. This was a recommendation given by the Lee of Faraman in 1923. Okay. So, next what happened is, in 1926, your first public service commission, 1926 October actually, okay, your first public service commission was set up under the leadership of Rose Barker. Okay, under the leadership of Rose Barker, the first public service commission was set up in 1926, and later we all know by the Government of India Act of 1935, a federal public service commission was set up. Okay, so that federal public service commission got the name changed by 1950 while we are enacting our constitution. That was changed to Union Public Service Commission. Okay, so that is the history of Union Public Service Commission. Starting from Charter Act of 1833, they wanted to include the Indians into the open competitive exam, but that was not taken forward. It was taken forward by 1853 Charter Act, and a committee called Macaulay Committee was set up. In 1923, a Royal Commission was set up under the leadership of Lee of Faraman, which gave some recommendation that is very important. And in 1926, the first Public Service Commission was formed under Rose Barker, and Government of India Act of 1935 gave recognition to this Public Service Commission, and this Federal Public Service Commission got changed into Union Public Service Commission after the end of the Constitution. So that is the tracing history of UPSC, and so that thing is very important. Okay. So, with respect to UPSC, whether they can be reappointed, reappointment of office, whether it can be done with respect to UPSC, generally they are no. Okay, that that office of reappointment, that is no, they can't be reappointed. Okay, that thing you have a clear understanding, because the member, a member of UPSC can become the chairman of UPSC. Okay, that is okay, but in generally the UPSC reappointment, it is no. Okay, so that is with respect to UPSC. So next we are going to see about the State Public Service Commission. Okay, so till now you have dealt with the Union Public Service Commission. Next we are going to State Public Service Commission. Okay, so what and all I told for UPSC, okay, like the composition, the term, removal, everything was same only, more or less same only, but there are some slight difference between your State Public Service Commission and UPSC. Okay, so now we will see the difference, only the difference we will see. The first difference is with respect to your appointment. Okay, with respect to this appointment, in UPSC the chairman and members are appointed by the president, but here, since it is state, the members and chairman are appointed by the respective governors. Okay, but the removal is with the president only. Okay, that is the important thing you should note here. Okay, the appointment is by the governor, but removal is by the president only. The next thing with respect to removal, okay, what I told, for removing a chairman or member of UPSC, then your president should refer that case to the Supreme Court. I told, no, here are the same thing only, but you don't confuse here, because most aspirants, since it is state, they think that it is the president will refer the case to the High Court. It is not so. Okay, he will refer the case to the Supreme Court only. Okay, so with respect to removal, that is one slight difference, and that is not a difference, but I am writing here because aspirants need to confuse here. That's what my intention. Next, I told with respect to UPSC, I told the jurisdiction of UPSC can be extended by an act of parliament. Here, what happens is the jurisdiction of State Public Service Commission can be extended by an act of state legislator. When your state legislator is passing an act, then your jurisdiction of SPSC can be extended. Then also with respect to the post, I told that the post under the UPSC that can be varied by the president, then your president should submit that to the parliament. That we all know. With respect to State Public Service Commission, it is with respect to the governor. The governor can alter the post, but for doing that thing, he should submit that report to the parliament, to the state legislator to get the approval. So there it is president submitting to the parliament, here it is governor submitting to the assembly. Okay, that is also one difference. Then with respect to reappointment, whether chairman or members can be reappointed to that post, no, generally it is no. Okay, so in general for UPSC and SPSC and for JPSC, reappointment, it is no, they are barred from reappointment. But one understanding is that there are, in SPSC there is a chairman and the members. Okay, so the chairman of SPSC can be appointed as a member of UPSC or member of chairman of UPSC. But next thing is your member of your SPSC, member of your State Public Service Commission, can be appointed as the chairman. Can be appointed as the chairman of SPSC or as the member of UPSC or the member of UPSC. So there is a hierarchy. They can be appointed to that hierarchy, but not to that office again and again. Okay, that is with respect to appointment, and that is a difference. Okay, so there is also one legal battle going on between SPSC and your State Vigilance Commission. Okay, that I told it is Central Business Commission. Here it is State Business Commission. Okay, it is a non-constitutional body, but this is a constitutional body. With respect to the removal of civil servant, government is going to consult both them, but your SPSC is having an edge because it is a constitutional body. Okay, that is the difference between with your SPSC and UPSC. So next we are going to JPSC. That is your Joint Public Service Commission. Okay. So when any two states, are requesting to the parliament, to the government, then your government by an act of parliament can set up this JPSC. So your JPSC is mentioned in the constitution, but the formation is by act of parliament only. Okay, so have a clear understanding that your JPSC has been mentioned in the constitution, but for formulating this JPSC, you should go by an act of parliament. Okay, so that is one important thing with JPSC, and the appointment and removal, it is done by the president only. Okay, the appointment, removal, everything is done by the president. What is the tenure? With respect to your State Public Service Commission, what is the tenure? Don't write 65 years of age. It is 62. 6 years of term and 62 years of age. Okay, with respect to state, because it is a state. But for JPSC, it is 6 years or 65 years or 62 years. Okay, since here also, it is your state is involved here, it is also 62 years. Okay, so with respect to your UPSC, the tenure is 6 years or 65 years. But with respect to your State Public Service Commission and Joint Public Service Commission, it is 6 years or 62 years of age. Okay, so that is with your tenure, and your appointment and removal, it is by the president only. Okay, so your JPSC is mentioned in the constitution, but for setting up this JPSC, you need an act of parliament. So with that, we are coming to the end of Public Service Commission. So have a clear understanding of these three. The extra point I told, the jurisdiction of UPSC can be extended, and the post under the who can vary, that can be asked as a one liner in your exams with respect to UPSC or some state government exams. So that thing be very clear. Okay, so with respect to this constitutional bodies in general, who is appointing, who is removing, whether he can be reappointed, that thing is very important. That I have dealt very clearly in the overview, in the tableau column I have dealt. Okay, so have that tableau column idea and about this things in detail. Okay, so with that, we are coming to the end of the Public Service Commission. Thank you.